All right, gotcha.
The October 17, 2016 meeting of the Anne Arundel County Council is now in session. Please stand for the invocation. Remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. Trumbauer.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Please bow our heads. Dear God, please give us patience and understanding and the wisdom to make good decisions, not only for our constituents, but for all county residents. Amen.
Amen.
And Mr. Chair, actually, I believe tonight we're joined by Troop 771, I think, and the Weeblos. They're going to honor us with starting the Pledge of Allegiance for us today.
Whenever you gentlemen are ready.
Scott, salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you. Madam Secretary, please read the ethics statement.
The Ethics Commission has asked that I advise you that under certain circumstances, members of the public may qualify as lobbyists when they testify before the County Council. If so, the law requires that certain information be filed with the Ethics Commission. The Chairman of the Ethics Commission has asked that those present review the Ethics Commission information in the foyer of these chambers. If there are any questions about lobbying requirements, speakers should contact the Ethics Commission in the Heritage Office Complex on Riva Road.
Thank you. I do want to make a note, I'm not sure if Mr. Smith planned on doing this, but Ms. Smith is withdrawing Resolution 6416. Is that correct, Ms. Smith?
Okay.
That's good.
Drop down a little bit.
I think the Bluetooth's on.
Here, stay put. There you go. Now say what you got to say.
No, I don't have any comments. I just want to make sure I was facing the right way.
Okay, so Resolution 6416 is being withdrawn. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the council briefly on any subject not on the printed agenda? I ask you to keep your remarks to 2 minutes, state your name and address for the record. Good evening.
Good evening, Julie Johnson, P.O. Box 6634, Annapolis, Maryland. I am back again because I do really want to encourage you to continue looking into the issues related to the radio frequency radiation that's released from your cell phones as they search, you know, around looking for the nearest cell phone tower to see if you have any messages, you know, phone calls or anything else. Because there's this constant interchange of signals, and there is also concern about smart meters, electrical transmission towers, Wi-Fi, you know, and a whole bunch of other, you know, sources of radiation. I do hope that you will share this with the people who have small children, because the younger you are, the more vulnerable you are to any kind of potential injury or harm. No one is saying because there is an international report that came out this last May that does say that these things are potentially, released radiation that is potentially carcinogenic, but they're not saying that they actually, you know, always cause cancer or anything like that, but they're potentially dangerous. And so everybody wants to take precautions. If there's a hazard out there, you know, you prepare and you avert any hazards, particularly, and everybody, you know, Mr. Grasso cares about the puppies and everything, but he really cares about little kids too, and I know all of you do too, and infants and toddlers are particularly vulnerable. But if it's your brains or your privates or your bodily functions, you want those to work well, and they can't if they're injured. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Is there any item any council member would like to place on the agenda? Mr. Grasso?
Well, I have a citation I'd like to talk about.
Please.
Okay. I got one of my prized constituents here, Ms. Lindsay Dadline. Come on up here, sweetie. Small for a bunch. Okay. What I'm so impressed about is that Lindsay, okay, everybody knows that I've took on one heck of a mission with Marley Creek and Furnace Creek, and before I got elected, I told everybody that I was going to make those two creeks, which seemed impossible, swimmable again. So within my second or third year, by health department standards, those two creeks were swimmable again. I spent probably close to $30,000 of my councilman's salary, as I pledged I would, and put about 40 fountains up and down Marley Creek. Well, Lindsay turned around and did a beautiful project and won first prize on my project on how the fountains work, how they aerate the water and clean the bacteria. So some of the things that she did, okay, of course, she's got a nice picture for some of you folks that might be able to see it of the fountain out there. And she did a nice science project, you know, our table of contents, the furnace creeks and the fountains. She did a nice PowerPoint explaining how the fountains work and why she chose that topic. I've always said over and over again that, you know, no matter what party you're a part of, that the most important thing in the world is the environment, okay? It should never be put at the bottom of the list. It should always be put at the top. And I'm a Republican, just so everybody knows that. Because it doesn't matter whatever, it doesn't matter how many police we got, doesn't matter how many teachers we got, doesn't matter about anything if we're all dying from cancer because we can't drink the water or breathe the air that we're breathing. So I'm just so proud that we have someone like Lindsay over here that's learned so well in our schools, which is a real tribute to our public schools, that she picked this up and she ran with the ball. And like I said, she pulled on first place. And that's something to be said. So what we're going to do here, Lindsay, is we're giving you a citation award. And it says, in recognition of your success in winning first place at the County Science Fair with your project, Furnace Creek and its fountains, your hard work and enthusiasm for the fountain project is noteworthy and significant and shows your interest in the positive environmental impacts of the fountains on the creek. The County Council congratulates you on your award-winning project and wishes you to continue success. And of course, it's signed by myself and all my colleagues because we're extremely proud of you. Congratulations, kid. Okay. Let's get a picture. Photo op time. Proud family.
My mother used to do that.
That's great. Congratulations, Lindsay. And see your parents are beaming right now with how proud they are, and your sister as well. May I have a motion that the partial reading of any bill, resolution, or minutes constitutes the reading of the whole?
So moved.
Second.
Madam Secretary, please read the minutes of October 4th.
The meeting was called to order by Chairman Derek Fink at 7 p.m. and opened with the invocation given by Mr. Peruka.
May I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved, Mr. Chair.
And I'll give you a second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Minutes of October 4th, 2016, stand approved as read. Madam Secretary, please read the titles of the bills to be introduced this evening.
Bill 7716, an ordinance concerning zoning, licensed premises of licensed growers and processors of medical cannabis. Bill 7816, an ordinance concerning public works, utilities, lien enforcement of connection charges. Bill 7916, an ordinance concerning disposition of real property, non-buildable property.
Please read the title of the resolutions being introduced this evening.
Resolution 6516, resolution approving the declaration of certain county-owned property known as the Mead Village Water Tank Site, located at 1635 Mead Village Circle in Severn, Maryland, and near Camp Mead as surplus property.
All right, Madam Secretary, please read the title of Bill 6616.
An ordinance concerning real property tax credits and fee exemptions, residential rehabilitation.
Mr. Marzick.
Mr. Grasso's bill. Mr. Grasso's bill.
Mr. Marzick. No, Mr. Grasso. Mr. Grasso, it's your bill. I don't know if you have anything to comment on that. You want to get right to the administration?
Yeah, I pretty much, I always take an opportunity if I can shoot my mouth off just a little bit. It's always a good thing, at least in my eyes anyway. Like I've told plenty of people before, the bill stands on its own. I think it's a great investment in our communities, whether you be a business or a person. And the best part about it is that it like I've said plenty of times before, it allows people to tear down an old project, an old house that is not environmentally friendly, that can also have lead-based issues, and can have a host of other problems. It's not properly done with stormwater management. And to tear this building completely down and to make it into a current house of today's society, which is most likely going to be much more green, green energy efficient. Stormwater management's going to be in good shape. We take away the lead-based paints. And then on top of that, we have incentivized, whether it be a business person or a homeowner or a young couple, to tear the place down, start a fresh, brand new house there, and we turn around and give you your permits for free, and we also give you a tax credit based on the old assessment, whatever it may have been, and the new assessment. Now, I got a phone call today from a nice lady on the phone that they were very much interested in spreading this into rehabilitation type houses. The only problem with that at this point is that for us to be able to get our tax credit, there's nothing in COMAR or state law that tags along with what we're doing to be able to do a tax credit on rehabilitation houses. So what I've asked the lady to do is to speak to Senator Simon Ayer and ask them to put in a piece of legislation that will identify in COMAR what exactly rehabilitation is. And once that is in place, then I would ask the council to indulge another bill to come into play and allow people that have a house that don't want to tear the house completely down but must meet the guidelines of rehabilitation, so that would make whatever that may be, taking out the windows, new roof, new electric, new plumbing, new stormwater management, whatever the case may be. But at that point, we can't address that right now, so I'd like to stand on what my bill is right now, and I hope that the council will support it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anything further comment than you did 2 weeks ago?
No, Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Bernie Mars, in the County Executive's Office. We're very supportive of this bill, and thank you, Mr. Grasso, for working with the administration and other members of the council to address the concerns that were raised with this. And
it's great.
We
thank
hope
you.
The council will support it.
Wonderful. Any questions for the council? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and open up the public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on Bill 6616?
Julie Johnson, P.O. Box 6634, Annapolis, Maryland. I am even more opposed to this bill than I was last time, because last time I somehow didn't quite catch that we are waiving so many different fees in this bill. I have serious concerns. I thought about, you know, dramatizing this with tricks and treats here. These are strong, heavy benefits to people who have the resources to come into a property and demolish the existing home and completely replace it. If you buy it for $350,000 and then you completely replace it, you're not going to sell it for $350,000. You are looking at least $150,000, $200,000 more perhaps, because it costs a bit to demolish and remove all of those materials, especially if they're contaminated with asbestos or lead. I think that this is really an inappropriate use of taxpayer funds to subsidize builders and developers and the real estate interests in the county. We have young people who have grown up in this community. Their families are part of the community. You know, the properties that are almost affordable, where you can put in sweat equity and improve it yourself, are being snapped up by developers who have no long-term interest in the community. They simply come in, do the rehab, hold on to it maybe for a while, and then sell it off. And what you're doing is, yes, the part of the, you know, that's definitely a treat for the developers. The trick is that you're hitting every group of taxpayers, because whether you're a renter or an owner, you're subsidizing through your property taxes all of these builders and developers. You're also picking up the tab for the costs of the inspections and permits and everything else, because that's a very large staff. Why should these people be granted waivers? And if their customers can afford a $500,000, $600,000, $700,000, $800,000 home,
please summarize.
Thank you. If they can afford those kinds of homes, they are far, far more capable of paying the fees that are due and payable than the people who are living in $200,000 homes.
Thank you. Public hearing on Bill 6616 is now closed. Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6616.
An ordinance concerning real property tax credits and fee exemptions, residential rehabilitation.
Any discussion? Seeing none, Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Aye.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
7 in the affirmative, none in the negative. Bill 6616 as amended is passed.
Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6716.
An ordinance concerning current expense budget, supplementary appropriations, police department grants, special revenue fund, partnership for children, youth, and families, special fund, Idlewild Special Community Benefit District.
Mr. Mars.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Bernie Marzik in the County Executive's Office. With me at the table is Stephen Thoreau from the Office of Budget. Lori Blair Klassmeyer from the Office of Law. As we discussed at the work session last week, Bill 6716 recognizes the revenues received from sources not anticipated in the budget, in the general fund and other special funds, and provides supplemental appropriation of a like amount. This supplementary appropriations for the General Fund Police Department, Partnership for Children, Youth, and Family, Idlewild Special Community Benefit District, and grants in both police and health department. Council should have received on Friday afternoon the updated MOU that was requested by the auditor at the work session for the police transport issue, and we would be happy to answer any questions the council may have.
That's great. Any questions from the council? Seeing none, we'll go ahead.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Prisky.
Ms. Dickinson, did you get a copy of that? Do you have any comments?
No, I don't know if you got my most recent blue letter from this evening, and I read the memorandum of understanding, and it says they're going to reimburse us for the cost of the two additional transport guards. So I'm fine with it now.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. We'll go ahead and open up public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on 6716? Seeing no movement, we'll close the public hearing. Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6716.
An ordinance concerning current expense budget, supplementary appropriations.
Please call the roll.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Prusky?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Nay.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
6 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative. Bill 6716 is passed.
Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6816.
An ordinance concerning current expense budget, supplementary appropriations, video lottery facility, local impact grant, special revenue fund.
Mr. Marzik.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Bernie Marzik, County Executive's Office. Again at the table, Stephen Thoreau from the Budget Office, as well as Lori Blair Klossmeyer from the Office of Law. This legislation recognizes revenues from unappropriated fund balance in the Video Lottery Facility Local Impact Grant Special Revenue Fund and provides supplemental appropriation authority of a like amount. This is $470,000 of the supplemental appropriation will be used for the Severn Health Center, and $80,000 will be used for the Video Lottery Terminal Community Grants. I'd be happy to answer any questions that the council may have.
Any questions from the council?
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Trumbauer?
Generally, I like to hear a little bit from the first district council member who has is more tuned in to the VLT process. I don't know if my colleague has had a chance to review this or has any thoughts to add.
I don't know if the mic is turned on.
You're on.
Okay. No, I had the opportunity to speak with Pam Brown and some members at the Total Healthcare, as well as some of the members, the Local Development Council. They're on board with this. I'm certainly on board with this. So flush up the shortcomings that they have with the funding that's needed to fund the projects. It has taken a little bit longer than it normally should have. They are in the process of going through HRSA and as well as going through the members of their board to finalize the planning of the project, but I'm totally on board 100% with this transfer.
Great. Thank you. Any other discussion? Go ahead and open up the public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on 6816? Mr. Enright?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the council, ladies of the staff. My name is Patrick Enright. I live at Huntwood Drive in Gambrels. I'm here tonight to say that I think this bill is great. I think it's an excellent use of the VLT money. I only have a housekeeping comment that I discovered in the fiscal note, which, as just stated, the $470,000 for Severn Health Center. When exploring the Department of Health's website, I couldn't find any such specific entity as the Severn Health Center. I did find a Pioneer City Family Health Center in Severn, which I understand is in bankruptcy proceedings. And then Mr. Smith said that the replacement for that is apparently a Total Health Center. And I'm only recommending a housekeeping change to change Severn Health Center in the fiscal note, or at least officially the recipient of the check is the one that's really in that it's intended for, and not to perhaps send cash to a bankruptcy proceeding. So that's all I have. Let's bring that up.
Thank you, Mr. Enright. Any other discussion? Go ahead and close the public hearing on 6816. Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6816.
An ordinance concerning current expense budget, supplementary appropriations, video lottery facility, local impact grant, special revenue fund.
Any discussion?
Mr.
Walker?
Mr. Marzik, would you care to address that? I don't, just to clarify for the record.
Maybe Mr. Thoreau can give an answer that this transfer goes to the general fund that will then have to go transfer back to the capital budget when the money is actually assigned. This was part of the budget that was approved in May or June by the council. I believe there was initially $2.1-ish million in there for this project. As far as the title, I'm not sure if that makes a difference at this point, but.
So this bill, members of the council, Stephen Thoreau from the budget office, so this bill just is going to move money from the fund balance over to the capital budget fund without another appropriation bill or through the budget ordinance. And FY18, these funds actually can't be expended in the capital budget fund.
So the name change could take place, or the correction of the name could take place during the budget process, then, or it would take place during the budget process. Mm-hmm. Got it. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Abstain.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
6 in the affirmative, 1 abstention. Bill 6816 is passed.
Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6916.
An ordinance concerning property taxes, capital facility connection charges and deferral, stormwater remediation fees, interest and penalties.
Mr. Marzik.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Bernie Marzik in the county executive's office. With me at the table is Julie Musog and Darcy Good from the Office of Finance, as well as Lori Blair Klossmeyer from the Office of Law. As we discussed at the work session, Bill 6916 would reduce the interest rate of 1% to 0.5% per month for late payments and property tax refunds. In addition, will add a penalty of 0.5% for late payments. The total revenue collection from the late payments will remain the same, but the county will, with the cost of the county for the refunds of an overpayment on property taxes due to incorrect assessments from the State Department of Assessments and Taxations will be reduced by half. As we discussed, the work session was about $500,000 down to about $250,000. State law requires the interest rates to be the same and the refund to be the same as that, requires the interest rate for the refunds and the late payments to be the same. Under this bill, those rates would be at 0.5%. We would add the penalty of 0.5% per month for the late payments. We'd be happy to answer any questions that the council has.
Any questions from the council? We had a pretty lengthy debate in the work session. Go ahead and open up the public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on Bill 6916? Seeing no movement, the public hearing is now closed. Madam Secretary, please read the title of 6916.
An ordinance concerning property taxes, capital facility connection charges and deferrals, stormwater remediation fees, interest and penalties.
I do see we have an amendment. Madam Secretary, please read the title of Amendment 1.
This is a technical amendment to remove language from the bill that was previously removed from code by bill number 1115 and is not existing code.
A motion to adopt?
So moved.
Second. There we go. Marzik, anything else to add other than that great description?
No, I guess just to put it in other words, that in the drafting, this was an oversight where there was language in the code that for whatever reason was not included in the drafting of the bill, so it's just a technical mistake.
Very good. Any discussion on the amendment? Madam Secretary, please read amendment number 1, or call the vote on amendment 1.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Aye.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
7 in the affirmative, none in the negative, amendment number 1 is passed.
Being that it is a technical amendment, we'll vote on the final bill tonight as well. Is there any discussion on the final bill? Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Nay.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
6 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative. Bill 6916 as amended is passed.
Madam Secretary, please read the title of 7016.
An ordinance concerning lease agreement, 122 North Langley Road, Glen Burnie, Maryland, Anne Arundel County Behavioral Health Building.
Mr. Marzik.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Bernie Marzik at the County Executive's Office. With me at the table is Samantha Harris and Christine Romans from Central Services and Jason Fetterman from the Office of Law. Bill, as we discussed at the work session, Bill 7016 amends a lease currently held by the county. In May 2006, the county entered a lease on behalf of the Health Department for 122 Langley Road in Glen Burnie with 1907 Lincoln LLC. The lease expired, ended on June 30th, 2016. The amendment before you adds an additional 10-year option to the agreement beginning June 30th, 2026. So beginning July 1st of 2016, the rent will increase by 2% annually, and all other items in the agreement will remain the same. We'd be happy to answer any questions the council has.
Mm-hmm. Any questions from the council? All right, we'll go ahead. Ms. Smith?
Quick question. I thought we were in the process of eliminating significant leases. I think, you know what? I saw the 10-year lease. Is that a new process, or did they mention something about a 3-year term previously?
Samantha Harris, real estate manager. This was previously a 10-year lease, and under new negotiations, another 10-year lease was negotiated.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the last part.
This is a new lease under a new renegotiated term of 10 years. 3 years was never part of the discussions.
Okay, all right.
All right. Yeah, we'll go ahead and open up the public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on 7016?
Julie Johnson, PO Box 6634, Annapolis, Maryland. I just have a question about what the actual rent per month will be. It says in the second whereas that it's a term of 10 years, and the rent was reduced from $20.71 per square foot to $15.68, but it will increase by 2% for each year. So how much are you adding each year to, you know, and what will the final rent be after 10 years? Because I don't know how, you know, where they're calculating the 2%. Because it looks like it could wind up being a significant increase over the current rent. And if it is a significant increase over the current rent, perhaps we should, enter a lease that's shorter term. Because we're looking at fiscal responsibility, fiscal conservatism. We certainly do need health care for the people who have mental health issues. But I think that I would appreciate this being clarified. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go ahead and close the public hearing on 7016. Madam Secretary, please read the title.
An ordinance concerning lease agreement, 122 North Langley Road, Glen Burnie.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Prusky?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Aye.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
7 in the affirmative, none in the negative. Bill 7016 is passed.
Right. Madam Secretary, please read the title of 71.
An ordinance concerning Article 1 General Provisions.
All right, Mr. Marzick.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Council, Bernie Marzick, County Executive's Office. With me at the table is Lori Blair Klossmeyer from the Office of Law. We had a discussion on this bill as well at the work session. This is the first step in the county executive's comprehensive cleanup of the code. This Article 1 rewrite goes through and makes changes to the article that need to be clarified for clarity, but also for efficiency within the code. The goal of this project is to update the code where necessary and delete outdated sections of the code as well. As we mentioned at the work session, when we find more significant items, we'll bring those to the council as separate bills, as we did with the county seal, which came before the council a few weeks ago. The Office of Law provided a detailed summary. The auditor also provided a detailed summary of the legislation. We'd be happy to go through that if the council wished, or we could just answer questions about specific provisions. And we will also be offering two amendments at the appropriate time.
Any questions from the council?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Prusky.
I was reading the blue letter provided by the county auditor, and I noticed that Title 8, urban renewal, is being repealed under this bill. I don't know if the administration had a statement on why. I mean, I know there are redundancies, obviously, in the code, but certainly there could be a concern, because some of the things that I look at when we talk about urban renewal and making sure that we handle, you know, projects and other things that may be a blight or whatever else. I don't know if there's any particular rationale for that. And then also, do you know where they're covered? Because the assumption is that they're covered in other places. So do we have citations or areas of where that would be covered?
Sure, Mr. Prusky, we laid it out in the summary from the Office of Law. The last urban renewal project was Glen Burnie Town Center, and that's completed. Any other efforts at Glen Burnie, at the Town Center, or other areas would be undertaken under different state and local planning initiatives, as this is no longer used by Economic Development Corporation. This section, Title 8, is no longer used. I don't know if Ms. Blair wants to expand on that at all as far as what areas, your question about what areas of the code.
Yeah, I was just curious on some of the things that were in the urban renewal program. I mean, obviously, you're right. Some of those projects are there, but there were certain things, especially when I'm looking at, like, the hotels in my area or things like that. Are we removing things that we may need later on? I'm just trying to, you know, to see, to make sure that we're not unintended consequences. You know, I understand the cleanup piece. I mean, certainly respect that, and I'm generally going to support the bill. I just have that question if to make sure we're covered in other areas.
Lori Blair, Deputy County Attorney. My understanding is this urban renewal is no longer utilized, and there are various state programs, including things like designating revitalization areas and other community-type areas that are under state law, under Department of Housing and Community Development. We can certainly provide you with a more detailed list. Arundel Community Development Services works in those areas with the revitalization type attempts and things of that nature. So we can certainly get you more detailed information on exactly what those state programs.
Yeah, there were a few sections. We can talk further about where I'm concerned to make sure that we're covered in other areas. I totally get, you know, the program itself and what you referenced, but I just want to make sure that we're also not removing language that could be a tool for the county.
Okay. Sure. If you have specific questions, please fire them away at us, okay. And we can have Economic Development or Community Development Services address
those
too.
Thank you.
Mr. Omar? Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Marzik, I don't recall us talking about this particular part in the work session, but if we did and I was not part of that conversation, just remind me. But in Title VI, the curfew language is being proposed to be in any area of the county, and several people have brought up to me whether that might include private property in that definition. For instance, county can't practically prohibit people from running around on their own property at night, can they? I mean, is that your intention?
I don't think that's the intent. I think maybe Office of Law will be better to answer kind of the specifics as well.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, I looked at, I got this question as part of the second blue letter.
Yeah.
So I've had about an hour, but I took a look. I couldn't find anything that would prohibit the county from declaring a curfew that would cover private property. I looked at the order that was entered in Baltimore City for the riots after the Freddie Gray matter, and that applied to all property in Baltimore City. I did not find anything where that was challenged. In addition, Baltimore City has a juvenile curfew that isn't part of their law that is always in effect, and it includes some private property. So I didn't find anything that prohibited that. Also, in the state code, where the governor can impose a curfew, there's no limitation on the type of property on which the curfew could occur. So I could foresee a situation where you would have something incredibly serious that perhaps you would want people to be in their houses and not outside their houses, and in either the entire county or just in a particular area of the county where there was a particularly serious emergency at the time. So I'm not sure, and let me just say, I'm not sure what the intent of the original language was in the definition of curfew, because it talks about roads, doesn't say public roads. It talks about public property, and then it says vacant premises, which to me implied would not be limited to public property. So I don't know if there was a previous intent to limit to public property, but if it was, it was ineffective. So
understood. What I'm hearing you say is that as you interpret this, it would include private property, but I think I heard Mr. Marzik say that wasn't necessarily the administration's intention.
Yeah, you know, This issue was just raised to us as well with the blue letter, and I'm hoping that we can amend the bill tonight with a couple of amendments that are offered, and then we have time to get back to the council on this
one. Sure. Well, I suspect this is going to be one we'll be talking about for a few weeks. So I'm not expecting you guys to have a fix right now. Right. I just wanted some clarity on whether you think this means what I think it means.
So. Right. If you have a perspective too, we'd love to hear it from anyone in the council.
Yeah.
As
well,
far as what the
I haven't quite gotten my head around it. I just wanted to know what your guys' intention was because
right. My first reaction when the question was raised by the auditor was current law would presumably allow it on private roads or public roads because it just says roads.
Right.
But whether that's the intent or not, that would be private property. So
okay. Well,
I think you need to do a little bit more of a dig.
I think we'll have 2 weeks for you guys to determine if you want to clarify it.
3 weeks.
Good call. Three weeks.
Love those 5 month Mondays.
Thank you,
Monday
Mr.
months. All right. Any other discussions? All right, we'll go ahead and open up the public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak on Bill 7116?
Just one.
Julie Johnson, P.O. Box 6634, Annapolis, Maryland. I have a lot of objections to this bill. It is large. It encompasses a lot. And it creates powers that I do not think existed previously. One just starting tidbit is on page 2 with the rules of signatures. I believe signatures should be in writing. If you've got a county official who's not capable of writing, is he really capable of performing his duties? If it's a citizen, then there would be a normal standard procedure for having a citizen sign something. When you skip over to subpoenas and oaths, since when did the chief administrative officer of the county, the chief of staff, the director of inspections and permits, planning and zoning officer, personnel board, director of public works, county attorney have the authority to conduct investigations, inquiries, or hearings in which they would subpoena witnesses? I thought those were judicial functions and not executive functions. And I have very strong objections to those people having the powers to, expanding their powers because if they are conducting an investigation, how can they be non-biased? If there is some problem with a building permit, then you don't get the permit if you don't produce the documents. Why would the chief of staff? I mean, I may have met the chief of staff, but I don't know. But, inspections and permits and planning and zoning, we have a hearing officer and a board of appeals system. And I don't think it's right or proper to expand or to confer judicial powers on, executive employees.
Please
not enough time
Michelle.
To state all of my complaints, but I think that this is a bill that needs extensive reduction in scope. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing on 7116. Madam Secretary, please read the title.
An ordinance concerning Article 1, General Provisions.
All right. I do see we have three amendments. Madam Secretary, please read amendment number 1.
This amendment increases the number of years minutes shall be retained from the suggested 5 years to 10 years.
Motion to adopt.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Second.
And there's a second. Mr. Peruski, I don't know if there's anything to add to that. Description is pretty straightforward.
Yeah, just based upon the last meeting, typically, again, it's generalization. You have a council member serving 8 years, a county executive serving 8 years. I think 10 covers a little bit more in terms of history if somebody had questions that were raised. And I just think it makes more sense. I understand reducing it certainly from 20, but I thought that 10 made a little bit more sense.
All right, any discussion? Mr. Marzik, any comment?
No, I think our intent was to make this section in the same lines as state law, with the idea being that when the state law would change, ours would change as well, but going to 10 years, we have no objections to that.
All right, any discussion? Madam Secretary, please call the roll on Amendment 1.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith? Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Aye.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
Seven in the affirmative, none in the negative. Amendment number one is passed.
All right, Madam Secretary, please read amendment number two.
This amendment removes the new language changing the definition and minutes requirements of a special body from state law and retains the current code language.
Do you have a motion to adopt?
So move.
Second.
All right, Mr. Walker?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is, I was reading through the blue letter from the auditor, and under Title III, under the Title III provision, the very first bullet point, Madam Auditor highlights that this changes the definition of a special body to a public body as defined by the Maryland Open Meetings Act. My concern in putting this amendment forward, I guess the concern is with the language that's in front of us in this bill, is that there's a potential for a special body currently under the provision that's in the code. They're forced to, because our definition is broad, not just to include the state definition of a public body, but it's a special body, which my understanding is a little bit broader, forces all of those groups that might be formed either by the county council or by the county executive or by the CAO to retain minutes and be subject to the Maryland Open Meetings Act, thereby giving constituents who have an interest in whatever committee this, whatever reason this committees, these committees or bodies are formed for, in having access to what those committees discuss. And so my concern is that by limiting the scope of our current code to this, the definition of public body as defined in the Maryland Open Meetings Act, that we're in fact, the potential is there for us to have a situation where a committee is set up, has discussions about county government business that impacts our citizens, our constituents, and yet that body wouldn't be then held to the same provisions as they're being held to currently in the code, which is to have minutes produced and access to those minutes by the citizenry. So my amendment does as it describes. It strikes the language that's being proposed currently and leaves the definition of special body or the term special body in the code. Therefore, I guess the administration's trying to propose it to be public body as defined in the Maryland Open Meetings Act and references that, but I just think it needs to stay at this broader level, and those people need to be subject, those meetings and minutes need to be subject to inspection by the citizenry. So that's the purpose of the amendment.
Administration?
Well, I apologize because I did not receive this amendment, but in looking at this, it seems as if it's narrowing the scope as to what is covered as opposed to broadening the scope. It seems that our definition would broaden the scope to cover all of those covered by the Open Meetings Act, whereas this would be very specific as to what is covered.
So
I guess
the Maryland Open Meetings Act, if you don't mind me interrupting, sorry.
Sure.
It says, except as discussed below, the act does not apply to bodies that exist simply as a result of longstanding practice, informal arrangements, or other means apart from any of these formal government enactments. So I guess I'm not an attorney, but my interpretation based on my conversations with Ms. Tate and what's laid out here in the blue letter seems to me that by connecting our code definition to public body, it's limiting it to these bodies that exist as defined in the Maryland Open Meeting Act, as opposed to our term of special body, which has the potential to include other groups that are formed by the administration or the legislative branch.
I guess which groups would this definition not include that the current definition would include?
That's a good question.
That's a question for them.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think that yours narrows it down. I think ours covers everything, whereas yours only covers these specifics, is the way I understand it from the Office of Law, that under the Open Meetings Act.
But theirs is only covering what's, yours is only covering, as I understand it, what's in the Maryland Open Meetings Act, which isn't everything.
That's my question, what's not covered?
But it's at least everything that's here.
I'm sorry, it's at least everything that's currently in this section. For example, it says appointed by the county executive, the two or more persons, which is what's in here, is what's in the State Open Meetings Act. Appointed by the county executive, and it, I believe the Open Meetings Act, I don't have it right in front of me, but it indicates appointed by the local governing body, or it may even say directly executive order or something of that nature. So that's covered. County council, the county council can only act as a body, so you would have to do a law or a resolution, and it covers any group that's formed through a law or a resolution. It covers all the bodies that are formed under the, that are required to be formed under the charter and the code. So I'm not sure. It includes a citizen committee appointed by the county executive. They would be under the Public Information Act, definitely. I'm not sure exactly what an ad hoc committee appointed by the county council would be, or if there ever had been any, but it seems to me that if you're appointing a committee, you're going to do something. In order to act, you'd have to do at least a resolution to appoint a committee. So I think that everything that's in here, there's no intent to exclude any thing that's currently covered. I think by referencing the Public Information Act, Bernie's right, you are broadening. And when you have different language than what's in this required in the state, then there's a question of whether there's an intent to have it be different. I don't think there's an intent for us to have less coverage than what is covered. We can't have less coverage than what's covered under the Public Information Act. So I
Ms. Tate, would you care to weigh in at all?
It looks like a no.
No, I mean, I guess my question still is, if someone is designated by the county executive to put together a work group or an advisory group, are they covered? Well, if the county executive himself doesn't appoint the person, but someone on his staff does,
right.
And they have meetings,
right.
Are they going to be taking minutes? Is the information that's put together by that committee, is that something that's going to be available to the public?
It's not required either under the current definition of special body or under the Public Information Act if it is not directly appointed by the county executive. So if the director of the Department of Public Works decides he wants to put together a group of people to discuss the design of a particular facility that is the subject of a capital project, that is not an entity that's either a special body under the county code or a public body under the Open Meetings Act. So in no circumstance would that be required to have open meetings.
So how would you define the special body then, the way it's in the code now? You're saying that this is, that the way you've proposed it is more of a catch-all. It's catching everything.
It catches everything because
so
it has a whole list.
So how does the special body differ from the public body?
Right, under
I'm sort of asking Mr. Marcy's question back, but in the other way. Like what?
Isn't it just the fact that it's in state code?
It's in the state
code.
That's
what I heard you say. We're trying to bring it to state code. State code says public body, so we're saying public body, so everyone knows there's no intention to be any different.
Right, and it is broad. It's created by statute, created by constitution, required by state law.
But my point was
appointed
just
by
that
the county executive.
We could make it narrower. We can always make it narrower than state code. We don't necessarily need to comply.
That's not true. You can make this definition narrower, but everything that's covered by the state law
has to be covered. Correct.
Exactly.
Right. So, broader is what I meant. Sorry, not
yeah,
narrower.
Right.
We can include more.
Are you done?
I'm done.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Trummer.
Okay. So I understand you guys to be saying you are not looking to be narrower than state law, and you believe that everything that's included in the original language that has not yet been amended is also in the state law.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay. Why define a special body then if public body is already defined by the state? Why don't we just change all the references to be public body? That's what's confusing to me.
In other words, instead of calling a special body, call it a public body.
Well, we're essentially defining a special body, but we're saying it's what the state calls a public body, and then in our code, it just says special body, special body, special body.
Right. And
if,
What's the difference?
I thought about that, but I'm not, we would have to, and we could certainly do this, but no. You'd have to change everywhere that appears in the code.
Well,
it appears more than just in Article 1, I think.
I think that I'm aligned with the intention of the amendment sponsor, which was making sure that we weren't narrowing the definition at all. Right? What I'm hearing you guys say is we're not, and we wouldn't be able to be more narrow than the state definition anyway.
Exactly.
Correct?
We could
exactly.
be broader.
Okay.
So I think the amendment's moot.
I agree.
Okay.
I have a question, is okay?
Ms. Dickinson?
I yield.
Yeah, I still am not clear on what you were talking about. I see in our code that talks about an ad hoc committee appointed by the county council or the chair of the county council. And you said that we would have to have a resolution. Whoa. But if the chair of the county
people?
Council, yeah, if the chair can act
Hold
by
the heck on.
I'm not
himself,
sure that
this, right. then you don't need a resolution. So where is that? Accommodated in the state law.
I'm not sure that the chair actually has the authority to appoint an ad hoc committee.
Easy.
Because sorry, because the charter provides that the county council can only act as a body.
Right.
So I don't think
that
there's anything.
That part's not clear to me.
Right.
So maybe we are narrowing it. Maybe we have to narrow it because it's not.
Because it can't occur.
Because you. So that's a point. And right.
Mr. Chair.
And then the county council can only act through legislation, right. bill or resolution. So.
So let's talk about the important piece.
Can I appoint now?
Mr. Walker.
So, Ms. Blair, just getting back to my question just briefly, and I'm happy to withdraw the resolution if that what you're saying is which seems to be, I think, the consensus. What's the difference between a special body than in a public body? So if we're making this change to comply with state code, and you're saying this is capturing everything it needs to capture. What weren't we capturing before by just having the definition of special body?
We were not capturing the committees that exist in law, the committees that are required through constitution, you know, the groups that are required through the constitution. I'm sorry, the charter. Things that we're required to do by bodies that we're required to have by state law. Those kinds of things are not necessarily captured here.
And so we haven't been collecting minutes on those types of meetings?
Well, we have because we've been complying with the Open Meetings Act. My guess, and I can go back and research this, my guess is that this existed before the Open Meetings Act. So we okay. were imposing these requirements on ourselves before state law
Got it.
Required us to impose them on
if
ourselves.
If you could get back to me on that, I'd appreciate
sure.
it since we
okay,
have
we'll
2 weeks
that.
Because we've already got an amendment that's passed. Three
right.
weeks, sorry.
And it is just a terminology and issue. We were calling them special bodies. I don't know why. It's called public body under the state law. It's not intended to be a different term. It could be changed to public body and then change all the references throughout the code.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to withdraw my amendment number 2.
Can we get the second withdrawn
second.
And then the motion? Who was the motion?
I don't know. I did something. I withdraw one.
We got you, Mr. Romero. And the other? It was Mr. Walker?
I don't think it was me. Was it me?
Okay. Oh, okay. So both have withdrawn. We'll move on to Amendment 3. Madam Secretary, please read the title of Amendment 3.
This amendment changes the required amount of the surety bonds for county officials and employees from $300,000 to at least $300,000.
Motion to adopt?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
There's a second. Mr. Marzik?
I think the explanation is pretty self-explanatory. This was an issue raised by the auditor, and we just wanted to clarify that it's a minimum of $300,000 coverage.
Okay. Any discussion? Seeing none, Madam Secretary, please call the roll on Amendment 3.
Mr. Walker?
Aye.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grosso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Aye.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Aye.
7 in the affirmative, none in the negative. Amendment number 3 is passed.
All right, being as we amended this bill, we'll hear it in 3 weeks. Madam Secretary, what's next? Please read the title of Resolution 6416?
6216. 6216. And, the hearing is concluded, so it's just eligible for vote. Resolution urging County Executive Stephen R. Shue and Superintendent Terry Kokolas of the Department of Detention Facilities to decline to enter into any agreement with the federal government for the purpose of housing individuals undergoing civil immigration proceedings at any Anne Arundel County Correctional Facility.
All right. I think I saw an amendment earlier. I don't see it right in front of me. Do we still have it? Yes. Any discussion on that before we get into the amendment? Seeing none, Madam Secretary, please read the title of Amendment 1.
This amendment changes the resolution to request consultation with the County Council before execution of an agreement and inclusion of discussion of any agreement with the federal government in the budget.
All right. A motion to adopt?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
There's a second. Mr. Walker?
Mr. Chair, as you'll recall, this is amendment is born out of the discussion back and forth between you and I at the last council meeting. You had expressed a desire that, and I think I had as well, to reserve judgment, not to come out and state that the county executive shouldn't move forward, but that he should do that in consultation with us. In addition to that, I think I laid out why I think this needs to be included as part of the budget process, because it involves hiring and staffing at the detention center, and it should be something that's included as part of that. So that's why I'm bringing this amendment to the resolution.
Very good.
Mr.
Strombauer?
Thank you. So I've read through the amendment, and it doesn't align 100% with what my original intention is for the resolution, but I think it does mostly, and so I'll consider this a friendly amendment to the resolution.
Ms. Marzik?
Mr. Chairman, members of council, Bernie Marzik in the County Executive's Office. We would ask you to vote against this resolution for three reasons. First, we believe this is a clear violation of the separation of powers between the executive branch and the legislative branch as to our responsibilities in addressing contracts such as this. In addition, the action contemplated by this amendment likely violates the charter for the action that the council is asking us to take with this resolution. In section 309, it says, neither the council nor any member thereof shall give orders either publicly or privately to any subordinate of the county council, of the county executive. In this case, Mr. Kokolis is that subordinate. Second, we believe that this resolution is condoning illegal immigration at a time when local jurisdictions should be working with the federal government to secure our borders. So we reiterate that we believe this is condoning illegal immigration. And finally, we will not enter any agreement that is not in the best interest of the county and the citizens of this county. So for those three reasons, we would ask you to oppose this resolution. The amendment.
Mr. Omar.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to give a couple counterpoints. Your first objection was that this is a contract, and so we shouldn't interfere with contract. I agree with you partially, except that I think there's a public policy element there. I mean, this isn't simply who's going to service our copy machines. This is, are we going to start taking these detainees in our facilities? So I disagree with your characterization of that. The second point was, we can't tell county employees what to do. I agree with you. I think the resolution essentially says, we don't like this and we urge you to do something. I can't imagine that that's illegal.
Can I respond to that, Mr. Trudeau?
Oh, please, yeah, I mean.
The issue that you're asking us to do in this resolution, the resolution itself may not be violating the charter, but if you're telling us you want to consult with us on this contract or this agreement, that is what violates the charter. I think that's pretty clear.
But if we were having this discussion as part of the budget process that you needed to allocate funds in order to accommodate that, wouldn't that meet that same characterization?
I would say no in agreement like this. We have thousands of agreements that come before the council or before the county executive and the CAO every year, and this is one of those agreements.
So that objection is new to this amendment. It wouldn't have been an objection to the original resolution, because we didn't contemplate being part of
Correct.
The process. We just told you, or
Correct.
At least my resolution said I didn't want you to do it.
Correct.
Okay. Well, thank you for the debate.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Marsdick, a year ago, I think it was a year, we voted on a resolution that essentially asked the county executive to cut funding for nonprofits. We sort of took a stand saying I didn't support it, but we as the council sort of passed it. And the county executive in the future budget reduced the funding for nonprofits and then absorbed it within other entities. How was that process any less different than this one, where we're urging the administration to, you know, consider not going into any sort of negotiations with the federal government, just as we were going into negotiations with nonprofits of the county. But yet we passed that resolution and there was no issue.
That's not what this amendment says. This amendment says that we should consult with the council on the agreement before any agreement is signed. The original resolution said there shouldn't be an agreement. This is very different from that original resolution.
No. Mr. Chair? No, yes. No, go ahead. Thank you. Thank you for
Thank you. I'm confused with the budget talk. I mean, if maybe this question is for Ms. Dickinson, but if the county executive needs, and I know the answer, but if the county executive needs to add personnel at the detention center because of this, that has to come before us, correct?
Yes, it would have to come before you, but they have a lot of a turnover there, and they cannot fill their existing positions because.
No, I understand, but he can't hire more than we've allowed him to hire unless he comes to us.
Correct, and
if he needs to hire for turnover. We've already allowed that, so we've already said yes. You can have up to whatever the number is, 300.
Correct.
Security guards. So if it's a budget issue, it's going to come before us automatically. Is that correct?
Yes.
I feel like I'm missing a piece to this because this was something that was brought up 2 weeks ago, too.
Well, this is the type of thing during the budget process in May when we looked at the detention center's budget in detail and they starting new programs. We can see, oh, you're going to need appropriations for this. You're going to need appropriations. And that's the time that we have these discussions about new programs and whether the costs are set correctly, that kind of thing. So this is one where it was not in the May discussion at all and is a new program that they're contemplating. And at this point in time, they could use their turnover funds to fund any extra cost for this program. It should come before us in May again as a program which you could consider and decide whether or not to continue with it.
But if they use turnover, there's no additional cost to the county because we've already approved that money to be spent for guards, and that's what they'd be using it to be spent on.
Correct.
So there's no difference. They can't change the dollar amount that we've appropriated back in June.
Correct. They can. Correct.
And moving forward, if the federal government, if this program works and they sign a deal and it's successful, however you want to determine success, but for this purpose, we'll say it's successful and that it brings money into the county, they can't spend it unless we okay that.
You're talking about in May, correct?
Correct. Right. Well,
when they come back in May and ask
$2 million
for
in February. Payments, they can't spend that money unless we approve
it. If it's in excess of their current appropriations, correct, they'd have to come back to you and ask for more appropriations.
So the budget point is moot because they cannot spend money without us okaying it.
They could spend money on this program, but within their current appropriation authority.
We've already accepted, and it has to be for guards, which we've already approved. We've approved those guards. We've approved that money for new guards based on today's numbers or numbers back in June.
Yes. Correct?
Correct. So if it's more guards, if it's more prisoners, they can still only have the amount of guards that we appropriated back in June.
Correct.
And if they want if they want more, they got to come back to us.
I will say that the budget is controlled at the department level. And if they wanted to use some of their money for personnel to cover other costs, like contractual services, they could transfer those appropriations to that category and use it for something else.
Sure, but any department can do that for any reason.
Correct. I just wanted to clarify. They don't necessarily have to use their personal services appropriations.
Sure,
they could use others.
They can do that in planning and zoning and inspections and permits.
Correct.
I mean, there's nothing we can do about that. So, I mean, the budget point, if they want to spend more money, they've got to come to us anyway. So I wanted to make sure I wasn't missing something because that was a discussion last week, too.
That's correct.
Ms. Smith.
I do want to point out one thing. Certainly at the federal level, we have this thing called purpose, scope, and intent. And I think for us, when we approved the budget last May, we approved it with those guards with the intent of providing services for the population when it comes to inmates, general crime that's occurring in the county. I don't think the intent when we passed that budget was to use it to use the staff to resolve immigration issues. So for me, I think there's at least somewhat of a difference of what we're using the actual manpower for. When it changes to doing immigration, I think that's a different use of that funds that we applied, that we approved it for.
I would disagree with that, Mr. Smith. I mean, we've appropriated that for people in our jails, and we didn't say, hey, listen, if they rob a convenience store or, if it's a DWI, it's fine to go in our jails, but if they did A, B, and C, then they're not supposed to go in our jails. But I'll leave it at that. Any other discussion? Just go ahead and call the roll on amendment number three. Amendment number one, I'm sorry.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Black.
I believe that the sponsored amendment may be working on something. I don't know if he's going to want to
withdraw
this or not.
When he gets back, we'll work on what he's working on. Amendment number one.
Mr. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Nay.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Nay.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Nay.
Three in the affirmative and three in the negative, and the amendment fails.
All right. Please call a roll on the final resolution.
Mr. Smith?
Mr. Chair, is there something going on there that I'm not aware of, or?
We're doing roll call for 6216. Resolution.
A straight resolution vote on the resolution.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, wait. Mr. Walker walked back into the room, so I'm going to call his name first, Mr. Smith.
Okay.
Mr. Walker?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to... I'm working on an amendment in the back, if it's possible to hold the final vote.
Roll call right now, so... Can we table the resolution? Isn't that a supervisory motion?
What is it?
They can move to lay it on the table.
Okay, so lay it on the, and then that what holds it till the next meeting, or?
Postpone it to a specific time, which we move to.
Postpone it to the next meeting.
Make the motion. Time.
Like the most, make the motion to postpone it to the next meeting.
Second.
All right, Madam Secretary, please call the roll on postponing 6216 to the next meeting.
Mr. Walker.
Aye.
Mr. Smith.
Aye.
Mr. Grasso?
Aye.
Mr. Pruski?
Aye.
Mr. Perutka?
Nay.
Mr. Trumbauer?
Aye.
Mr. Fink?
Nay.
Four in the affirmative, three in the negative. Motion to hold resolution 6216 until the next meeting passes.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Grasso?
I'd like to take reconsideration on that vote.
On what vote?
Which you just took right now. Would you say
on the hold? No, that was just on hold. We're hearing the resolution next meeting.
All right.
Madam Secretary, please read the title of resolution 6416.
He withdrew that.
64 has been withdrawn. Is there any other discussion? Is there any other business to be brought before the County Council?
Move to adjourn, Mr. Chair.
May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. County Council adjourned until November 7, 2016.